I've been doing this for 25 years. I'm an evolutionary biologist. I do a lot of work with fish. And several years ago, Kristen came to the lab from the Fred Hutchinson Research Center and wanted to do some genetics on a new organism. So we found a mutant that had a curved back, and I gave her several mutants to work with, and then she started working mostly with what we call curveback, and then she's really developed this particular piece of it for us.
I originally was schooled in nursing, and then went into genetics more, and did genetics of cancer, and kind of wanted to get out of working with fruit flies, and so Felix had an awesome model. He had a really good background in genetics and working with less developed models, and so the guppy seemed really like there was a lot to discover with it.
The evolutionary geneticist is particularly interested in the mechanisms underlying those characters, and we kind of believe that to really understand the evolution of a species, you want to know the mechanism of the characters that are involved in their adaptation. So
there's a big gap between having our head in biology for a long time and then translating that to the orthopedic language. And at first, when we started seeing all these parallels between the human syndrome and the curveback syndrome, we really needed to talk to a human person to see if we were crazy or not, because it was a phenomenal parallel. Studying the human stuff a lot has sort of let us know where the holes are, where we can apply this model.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely seeing if some of the genes in the guppy are the same as genes in humans. That would be translated most immediately to screening children so that there wouldn't be false positives from tests like the bending over test. So if we were able to identify genes that correlate with this, we could really say whether people need to be watched. So guppy was originally studied since the 1920s. The genetics have been studied in the guppies, mainly because the males are like peacocks, and the females are pretty bland, and females are really choosy, and males have so many different colors. Geneticists have been trying to figure out where does all this variation in color? Brothers will look very different from each other. What do females like? And a lot of mapping has been originally done to find some of these color patterns.
They're particularly important because the female gives birth to live offspring, so that makes them a popular pet, but also a really good study organism in this case, because the part of the parallel is that they can be born without scoliosis but develop it more
later. That's one of the
later
things. So they're born with normal spines and they curve at various ages, just like humans during growth. This is a picture of the guppy spine. It's a CT scan, so this is probably familiar to you. This is a minor curve. And one of the main things, so when you ask if animals ever get it, any animal before that's ever shown spinal curvature has fusion or breaking around this region, or other parts of the vertebrae are messed up. So there might be a genetic thing causing the spine to curve, but there are obvious other defects. So with humans, it's called idiopathic because the children are otherwise normal. And with the fish, we're seeing that these are otherwise normal. And we confirm that morphologically by looking at their spine first to see if the vertebrae are normal. The cause is unknown. Why it progresses is unknown. What accounts for any of the variability is unknown. It's immense. And the amount of effort that has gone into trying to figure out these factors is pretty substantial. So it's a very complicated disease. So when we talk about it, when we talk about this to other people, we say, you know, the reason no one has been able to figure any of this out since Hippocrates is because it's really complicated. And we've sort of broken this down. One, all the variability. So children are born normal. The onset is anywhere from infancy to late juvenile period. It progresses gradually. You can't really see in girls or in humans when it's starting, so
yeah.
The onset time, the exact age is kind of unknown, but it's highly variable. The rate of progression is highly variable. Some stabilize, some actually get better, some get worse, as you're familiar with. and this variability is even within the family. And there's been some studies this year that even show that among monozygotic twins, so these are identical twins, we're seeing some variability for the magnitude of curvature.
So they both have a curve, but different amounts.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, yeah. So it's definitely a complex deformity. There's also developmental dynamics. So anything that happens after birth and to sexual maturity, which is the major growth period, is correlated to this progression. And no one's been able to weed out what is actually just getting caught along in the ride of the progression or was actually correlated to it and contributing to a risk factor.
Mm-hmm.
So these are the kind of animals that they do now, lamb, mouse, rat, chicken. And this is the sort of study. So in order to study it throughout development, because it's a four-dimensional deformity, right? We've got the, like you did in the beginning of your show, we've got the turning on this plane, we've got some turning on this plane, we've got the axial rotation, but then the fourth element is time. And so it happens during development. So in order to capture the fourth element, what they do is they like would tether a rabbit. So they tie a string from the hip to the shoulder here and force it to grow, deform over time.
What a bunny.
I know, it's really a sympathetic slide. And then it would hopefully some of the stuff that happens here would give you some insight into what's going on in humans.
Uh-huh.
The big question is, if you're inducing it, is it telling you anything about what's causing it to begin with?
Yeah.
So there's a bit of controversy over these, and these are different ways that they're inducing it. This is a really popular model. This is called the bipedal pinealectomized rat. So the tail and the front legs are cut off. In the 70s, someone cut the pineal gland. That's the one that makes melatonin and senses your light-dark cycle. Someone cut it out of a chicken and the chicken's spine curved. Well, because the chicken's bipedal, and because I've never seen it in any other animal, they said, this confirms that it's a bipedal specific deformity. It has something to do with being bipedal. Maybe it does. What we're saying is that it's not exclusively bipedal, it's just that you're not quadrupedal. I'll show you a slide that explains that in a minute, right? So they cut the thing out of the chicken, and some of their, it's not 100%, but some of their spine is curved. So then they start cutting the pineal gland out of everything they could. But it was a lead,
it's
right?
Research.
So everyone looked at melatonin to see, but no one could correlate melatonin deficiency with humans. So they looked at girls at all different times. They looked at their serum melatonin levels, and no one can figure. It never correlates to scoliosis.
Mm-hmm.
So it sort of hit a wall. One of the things that happened though is they took the pineal gland out of a rat, or they can just decrease melatonin levels. And as long as it's quadrupedal, it doesn't show spinal curvature. But if you cut off its front legs and its tail and make it bipedal, it has some curvature. So this further reinforces this is the premier model for studying this, which shows the deficiency. Right?
Uh-huh.
So with guppies, they're born alive, they're born with a normal spine, and the curvature develops after birth. It's highly variable. It increases with age. Some stabilize, some reverse to normal, some progress to super severity. And importantly, so generally at sexual maturity doesn't progress anymore. A little bit in the severe cases, same as humans. And there's a female bias for severe curvature, and it's exactly like humans. So in humans, the vertebrae are stacked like this. There's a growth plate here, and you've got force coming down in a, what we call cranial caudal, from cranial, the head, the weight of your head on your spine, and gravity is pushing down from above. And then the bipedal motion, or just standing from above, so there's this...
Yeah.
We're seeing this perpendicular curve here. And then in humans, this is considered one of the biggest clues to maybe what's going on is at the apex of curve, you get that warped. So the vertebrae actually start to get distorted right at the apex. And there's been a lot of study inducing it in rat tail or cow tail to try to get an idea of actually what could possibly be causing that. So we've never seen idiopathic curvature in animals, but it's probably because the biomechanics of the quadrupedal animal are so different that the force is actually never coming into contact with the growth plates.
Uh-huh.
So in fish, we see, just like humans, they're stacked like this, forces coming down like this. With fish, they're stacked like this,
uh-huh.
And force coming like this. So
mm-hmm.
They're swimming into water, which to fish is a pretty dense medium.
Yeah.
And then their tail beat motion is a lot like the bipedal motion. They even use the same neurological pathways that we use to make ourselves walk, they use the same one to beat. So what we're seeing is a similar sort of perpendicular curve, and then we're seeing the same distortion. So the fish vertebrae are shaped like a spool, but at the apex of curvature, they get distorted, just like here. So it could be some similar like molecular thing going on in humans and fish. And so so what we're saying is, it's not that it's human exclusive, it's that it's not quadrupedal that's
mm-hmm.
causing it. So we've got this parallel, and one of the complicating things about this sort of deformity is that it's completely interacting with our biomechanics all along the way. So the biomechanics involved in our growth and just the way our spine is interacting with this environment and walking is definitely impacting the deformity. So when you were asking about evolution, one of the interesting questions we would like to say is the genetic basis that's causing this also present in these guys, but you just don't see it because you need the biomechanics?
Mm-hmm.
Or is it just for some weird reason only in humans and fish?
Now that reminds me of when Treadwell, when we first brought these pictures and showing it to Dr. Treadwell, the orthopedic surgeon at BC Children's, and he said, well, there's no gravity. You know, he looked at the fish, he goes, there's no gravity. We didn't know what that meant, but what he meant was there's no gravity along that axis.
Mm-hmm.
But then Kristen, I think, figured out
mm-hmm.
that
that
it's really, it's the force, yeah, it's
force.
Compression along that axis can be as important in fish.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It could be interacting with our growth plates.
That's the unique thing that we have here, is that this is a genetic reason, or there's a genetic disposition to the curvature in this guppy model. And none of these other models, that pinnelectomized rat, they're all being induced. And so again, you don't know what's the primary cause.
Females will always get it more severe. So just like with humans, boys and girls, or female and male guppies, will have a similar onset rate, but females will get more severe curves as they mature. So a lot of people looked at the X chromosome. A lot of human studies tried to match up the X chromosome. Some said, yes, definitely. Equal amount said, no, definitely not. We looked at it, doesn't seem to be, could be hormones, could be growth rates. There are probably 5 to 10 different hypotheses that are circulating out there right now. It's probably you've got a predisposition, and then there's probably other things swimming around in your genome that are probably like a mixed bag of marbles. It's a hard riddle, but
mm-hmm.
From a scientific perspective, it's fun because it's so challenging. Our first paper was to do a review of all the different causes for spinal curvature among fish. And what we found was, just like humans, a lot of different things can cause spinal curvature in fish. Poor diet can cause spinal curvature. There were some reports of improper pH,
mm-hmm.
lightning. No one's ever been able to show what we call the idiopathic type, so no other deformities associated with it in otherwise healthy fish. No one's been able to show that before, and no one's been able to show a developmental context with this hereditary sort of thing.
Right.
You want to see fish? The pink tops is a breeding pair, or a pregnant mommy, and then all of her offspring we separate out and we keep in these smaller containers.
Okay.
So
I'm glad it's done well.
Well, this one just had babies just in the past hour.
Oh, yeah?
Here's a mom.
So this one's okay.
The colorful one is the boy. So that one curved fish that Felix had, I bred it with a guppy female. She had some offspring. We bred those brothers and sisters. We bred their offspring's brothers and sisters. Their offspring's brothers
and
sisters.
And this filled the whole room.
Half the room. Yeah. Yeah. Well, more than half the room.
Taking
over quite a bit.
Over my space, but.
Wow.
Yeah.
Oh, they're so curvy.
Yeah, they're cute.
And they're twisty too, huh? Oh yeah, this one's really twisty.
Yeah.
Curvy and twisty.
Yes.
These are low expression, these are high expression. So this is the beautiful thing with a model. So from that pedigree, we inbreed them to the point where they're genetically enriched for either making severe curve or minor curve. And then we can make these stocks. So these all have like maybe 20% are curved, and if they get curvature, it's pretty minor. And in this whole stock, we can just let them go. 100% are curved, and 80% have super curves. You know how we were saying how it's super complex and it happens during development, and there's all these different things that you could look at? I mean, we're talking about many different disciplines of science that really need to come together and work together. And it seems like scoliosis, okay, it's been around since Hippocrates. We're not making any progress on it. What's the new approach? We really need to get together with clinicians. It seems to be fruitful. Right now, our collaboration with, you know, Orthopedic Obesity Children's is, every time we get together, we have so much fun.
So this is where we do the molecular work. We're able to extract DNA from the guppies. We can do what's called PCR, where you can amplify different genes in these PCR machines, and then they get run out on the slab gels. And then basically we send off the pieces, the fragments, to get sequenced, either in Korea or in the States. So, yeah.
That's awesome.
Wow, well, we're covering lots of territory, and I think we'll need to wrap this up now. Thank you for your time,
and
for showing us everything.
Yeah.